great opportunity to be here today in front of all of you to introduce our first session. Thank you so much to Ron and the entire team at the National Association of Workforce Boards for having us today. Now, I know today is all about industry engagement, and who better to kick off the morning than retail, the largest private sector employer in the U.S., which supports 1 in 4 jobs. That's 42 million American workers. Not only is retail big, it's the place where many of us got our start. Retail provides first jobs for 32% of Americans, and it prepares America's workforce for success in many ways. Our next speaker will talk about the incredible evolution happening right now in retail and what that means for careers in our industry. You'll hear what some of those paths look like and what some of those jobs are like, and we are very proud of them. But we also know that the transferable skills learned in retail, skills like conflict resolution, learning how to successfully work as part of a team, the ability to interact with many different types of people, and being able to multitask, are valued by most hiring managers across all industries. So even if retail isn't the place where everyone chooses to spend their career, a first job in retail can set a person up for lifelong career success. In this industry, talent at all levels is hugely important. In fact, over a year ago, we asked a number of retail CEOs to share with us 3 things that keep them up at night. On every answer, jobs and talent were mentioned. And it's easy to understand why. This is an industry that's growing. In fact, retail has 600,000 entry-level jobs open right now that companies can't fill. Finding, keeping, and advancing employees at all levels is at the top of most retail leaders' to-do lists. That's where the NRF Foundation came in. We wondered, could we bring together the retail industry and build a bridge for the hundreds of thousands of people in this country who need jobs to prepare and connect them with the hundreds of thousands of open positions in retail? The answer is yes, we could, and we did. Earlier this year, we announced Rise Up, which stands for Retail Industry Skills and Education. Rise Up is a groundbreaking training and credentialing program to help people, regardless of educational background, economic means, or age, acquire the skills they need to land jobs in retail and advance into promising careers. We worked with dozens of retailers, nonprofit partners, and foundations to build the first component of Rise Up called Retail Industry Fundamentals, which prepares people for entry-level roles in stores, distribution centers, or call centers. It gives participants real-world, practical knowledge in areas like retail tools and technologies, customer service, retail math, inventory, and interview skills. And when graduates pass their exam, they will receive a credential that will be portable, transferable, and widely recognized across the retail and service industry. The Retail Industry Fundamentals credential costs $50 per learner, which covers the cost of online training and classroom materials, as well as the exam. Now, while some retailers, especially small businesses, will integrate this into their existing training program, we anticipate that it will mostly be delivered through nonprofits, high schools, and people like you, workforce development groups, the people who interact directly with the population this credential can help the most. Retail Industry Fundamentals is just the beginning. Moving forward, we'll be creating a broader retail credentialing program that will allow professionals to move around and advance in their careers in areas like data analytics, management, and supply chain. These programs are fundamentally about people, elevating them and encouraging them to succeed, about giving them the skills they need to flourish in this dynamic industry and watching them achieve great things. People like Ro, who started off as a cashier at the Home Depot and is now a regional vice president. Or Lynn, who started with Tractor Supply Company as a part-time employee while he was at a community college. And today, he oversees 160 stores. And Adriana, who came to America in search of a better life and was hired by Macy's before she could even speak English. Today, she's a manager in Macy's jewelry business and fluent in English. Retail was the only industry that would take a chance on her. In many industries, this is the exception, not the norm. That's not true in retail. For each one of those stories, there are a million more like them. We all have a story of our first day. And for many of us, that first day was in retail. That's why our industry felt so strongly about coming together to build its next generation.
Every morning across America, retailers open for business. But in this industry, it's never just another day. For many, it's a fresh start, a first job, that first chance. Every now and then, we meet someone who reminds us of that opportunity, and it makes us smile. Because somewhere along the way, we were given a hand up. That gentle nudge needed to take a risk. The encouragement to think about our future differently. That's why we're paying it forward. To help more people know the thrill of that first day and every day after. Because the future of retail isn't what, it's who. By coming together, we build the next generation of leaders. By coming together, we all rise up.
I'm so excited to introduce our next speaker, who is one of the most forward-thinking executives I know. As you'll hear, she is passionate about where our industry is going, and she has some very specific ideas on what and who it will take us to get there. Mindy Grossman came from the winner's circle of Tommy Hilfiger, Ralph Lauren, and Nike before taking the helm of HSNI in 2006. Relaunching the brand 2 years later and dramatically changing its corporate culture, today this multi-channel $4 billion online and mobile retail powerhouse has nearly 7,000 employees and reaches nearly 100 million households. Mindy said that when she first started at HSN, she knew that retailers would have to be poised to take advantage of technology and the rapidly changing ways in which people shop. And today, nearly half of the company's revenue is generated through digital commerce. It is a pleasure to welcome HSNI CEO and NRF Board of Directors Chairman, Mindy Grossman.
We've had an opportunity to chat, which has really been helpful, but I gotta tell you, this is amazingly nervous for me to do this. First of all, a $4 billion company that hits 90 plus million American households. This is like pretty incredible for me to get the opportunity to chat with you. So I really—
And vice versa after our conversation, it was terrific. I don't normally also get to have a lot of fun.
Well, I hope we can have a little bit of that, and I know that there's some powerful information that that you're going to bring us. But there is one question I really do have to ask. I mean, it's the privilege I get to sit here. So HSNI, you see a lot of stuff in the course of a day. Are you a shopaholic?
Self-admittedly. You know, the way I think about it, the best way to understand your consumer is to be her. So I knew I was in trouble. I knew I was in trouble the day the UPS man looked at my husband and said, "I am so sorry for you." You know, look, I get as excited shopping in a CVS as I do at HSN, as I do in Bergdorf's Goodman. But you know, that's very relevant for today. Because it's not just about shopping, just like retail is not just about selling. It's about discovery, information, education, entertainment, destination, and community. And it's all of those things combined. And especially today with what technology is enabling us to do, this idea of creating immersive experiences, and then it's also kind of cool to get the stuff afterwards.
I know, and you know, the UPS, the FedEx guys kind of know where my door is, and that's American Express is quite happy about that, by the way. You talked a little bit, or you mentioned technology as an industry that really kind of melds all of that. We were talking earlier about the app, the platform that you guys are working on. Where do you see HSNI? Where do you see this industry in the next few years?
Well, look, I think technology on one side, you can look at it as it's disrupted a lot of industries and business. On the other side, it's enabled us to do things that we never thought possible in being able to engage consumers. And as Ellen mentioned, I joined the company a little over 10 years ago. I'd spent 6 years at Nike traveling all over the world and seeing the explosion of mobile in Japan and in other countries before it really was highly adopted here, and realized that consumer behavior was going to change forever. And the ability to embrace that, and not just because of technology, but because of mindset and wanting experience, that's very powerful. And I was just doing a presentation, and the name of the presentation was "The Future is About Technology Plus Meaning, Enabling People to Live a Connected Life." And whether we're retailers or whether we're in other businesses, our greatest value is going to enable people to have a better life for themselves through understanding, through education, through entertainment, whatever that is. And the ability to do that today, because you can personalize things in such dramatic ways than you were able to do before. But I think the thing to remember, and this is what I would tell people here, because what you do is so important for the future, there are five things that we really have to remember today. And this is not just a prop, okay? The mobility, this is not a device. This is a destination. This is the most important connection point that we have in our lives today. And the average consumer spends between 3 and 5 hours a day, and it goes up for millennials, on this device, more than we often spend with family and friends. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing, but it's where we get our information. It's the first thing we look at. So mobility has changed things forever. So how do we personalize with that? I think the second thing, and as retailers, everyone is your competition today. We used to always look at our competition as the next guy down the street or the next website, but your competition is the last great experience someone had, whether it's Uber or Airbnb.
Right, and I love that, because we deal with workforce boards oversee the American job centers. We deal with millions of people a year, and that was one of, in our many fascinating things in our conversation, but that was one of them that really stuck with me, is that I remember my last experience, and that's the expectation I take in my next experience.
Right, and so it's very critical when you're thinking about that. And in our world, the way we had to think about it, so if you take the HSM business, for years, we had this incredible content that we distributed to 96 million people, but it was the same content to 96 million people. Today, we have to distribute 96 million personal experiences to 96 million people. And that is the expectation of the customer, that you know them. All the data will tell you that if you can personalize the experience, you will have more loyalty, you will stay with a brand. Now, only technology and this idea of being able to use data in a very directed way, hence why there's a whole new expansion of job needs in not just retail, but every business, data analytics, the ability to understand consumers at a different level is going to be very important. I think the third thing that you really have to think about, we kind of coined the expression, agile is the new smart. If you look, Thomas Friedman's book, Thank You for Being Late, and what he says is this ability to apply speed and agility to everything you do, because we don't know what next technology is going to disrupt us. So we have to be willing to be iterating and disrupting ourselves, right? Because if you're not going to do that, you're going to be disrupted.
Right. Somebody's going to do it to you.
Right. So I think, you know, that is really very critical. I think the other thing is, you know, we're all familiar with the hierarchy of needs. But what's happening today is the pyramid's been somewhat inverted. And if you look at the consumer, one of the key things that's critical is this idea of self-fulfillment. So what you have to be thinking, whether in your roles or whether in a retail role or any other industry, is this idea of how am I providing meaning? And then something you mentioned and Ellen mentioned that just goes without saying is talent is value. And talent that really is poised for the future, and talent that is engaged with culture, and talent that wants careers and robust futures is really critical.
So talking about technology, hashtag ask industry. If you go out to Twitter, I'm not the only one who's going to have an opportunity to ask Mindy a question. So if you go out on Twitter, hashtag ask industry, Donna Riles from Full Capacity Marketing assures me that this is going to like come up on the screen. So I want to ask that. When you talk about the impact of technology, how has that changed the jobs in your industry? You know, what changes happened to those jobs? What are the demands of those jobs today?
It's changed dramatically. And one of the really key elements, particularly the NRF and the NRF Foundation, which Ellen has led the charge the last number of years, and I was fortunate to chair the foundation for 4 years, really educating the educators and educating the workforce of the type of jobs that are going to be critical in retail. As she mentioned, we're 1 in 4 jobs in the U.S. And, you know, that's everything from the entry-level jobs that are going to turn into long-term careers. But just think of my business. If I think of probably 10 job postings that exist today, videographers, data scientists, consumer marketing, content specialists, entertainment integration, photography, all of these things that are creating really new opportunities within a huge business. And I find that incredibly exciting, because the opportunity to take, whether it's people on the creative side or the merchandising side or the analytics side or the MBA side, there's really something that we're going to need within our industry. And just to give you a statistic that I had recently heard, just Lockheed Martin as a company, if they hired every graduating data scientist over the course of the next number of years, they still would not be able to fill the needs of those positions. Now, that's just one company. Now, think of every industry. So, you know, I just had a grandchild, and I said, a little girl, and I said to my daughter, okay, when does the math start? Because that's what's going to be important. But it just tells you.
Does she have an account yet with HSNI?
Oh, trust me, it'll happen. but, you know, if you really think about it, that diversity of jobs, but what has to happen, you have to start it very early on. You have to start it early on in school. You have to look at curricula. You look at how we're preparing people for a future of workforce. But not only quantitatively, and if you look at Rise Up, which is a program we're very passionate and it's going to be very important, and you're taking kind of more entry level and you're giving them skills and capabilities, it's not just the quantitative needs, it's also the qualitative needs. And you were talking about your son, right? Mm-hmm. And the difference between, okay, I'm gonna meet with a patient for the first time, do I have empathy, do I have human skills, do I have capabilities to understand human behavior? That technology married to meaning is relevant across everything that we do.
Yeah, I was mentioning to Ellen earlier, I'm obviously a very proud father. My son recently completed his graduate work as a BS, now an MSN, mastered in nursing. And he started life because his father, you know, chose public service. He started working when he went to college, and he worked for the Gap and Banana. And he says now, as an RN, he can tell the difference between an RN who had those kind of experiences and an academic. Because there's just a little more empathy. There's a different, in his view, he has a different approach to the patient because of his understanding, his coming from retail. The stat about Lockheed Martin, I wish I'd have known that beforehand. John Gustafson is here from Lockheed Martin with an incredible program down
around Dallas. I hope I read that article right.
I would have asked him that trivia question yesterday. John, is it true that you guys could hire him?
But the other thing that's important, I think there are two other elements that have really changed the retail landscape. You know, so again, my background was more out of brands. It wasn't out of, you know, a traditional retail world. So when I had to come into my company and define what the future was, I started with a blank sheet of paper. And I said, you know what, we're not going to use the word channel, actually. We're going to think of the world as boundaryless retail. And what I mean by that is this 360-degree approach to using technology and innovation to create a seamless experience for consumers and to inspire them. And the reason we didn't use the word channel, if you think of it today, consumers don't shop by channel, right? There's no more silos. There's no more silos in our company. You really have to think of this idea of 360-degree experiences. The second big change for our industry and for industries in general, you know, we were trained and spent so many, you know, parts of our career with our entire focus getting customers to come to us on our platform, on our terms, where we were. The future is about distributed commerce. And what that means is you have to evolve and you have to become audience-centric and platform-agnostic. And what that means is you have to be able to communicate and you have to service the customer where they are. So you have to think about where your product, where your content, and you know where you're going to be. So you're seeing this, for us in general, yes, we still want people to come to watch our live platform, which we stream across every device. We still want them to have an immersive experience within our digital platforms. We still want them to look at our beautiful catalogs to drive them e-commerce. But we're also transacting and putting our content and our products on social media, Facebook, Instagram. We're partnering with other media sites to power the commerce off platform. We're streaming shoppable video on places like People.com and Vogue.com. Where the customer is going to be, because if our growth and our ability to be competitive is going to broaden our audience, we have to be where they are, and we have to understand their behaviors. So it's a very big change in many companies culturally, and in enabling yourself to have the technology to be able to do that.
And that all comes together, so the next time I log on to Front Gate, it says to me, no, Ron, really, didn't you want to buy this? You were looking at this. Didn't you really want
to? Hey, look, we've all had the thing where we looked at a pair of shoes, and for the next month, that pair of shoes is following us forever. And finally, they're like, I've just decided not to buy that pair of shoes. But, you know, it does go back to what I call authentic and relevant personalization. And the expectations of consumers they're just continuing to be raised. So if I am going to serve up content, you know, and sometimes it's going to be an offer, sometimes it's going to be what I call, how do you give people something generous? So if I know that someone purchased that Wolfgang Puck knife set when he was, you know, on HSN, the next time I communicate with them, maybe it's a video that's a recipe on how you're going to use your knives. So you constantly have to be thinking, what is your constant engagement tool? Because your ultimate goal is to be able to have that customer continue to engage with you versus to go somewhere else. And it is a very competitive environment. That's not going to abate. So if someone is going to decide to spend with you, and they, you know, and we talk about share of wallet, and you know, people have a lot of choices. They could spend it on experiences, they could spend it on technology, or they can spend it on product. What are you providing them to inspire them to want to engage and ultimately want product? And as retailers, that's what we're all trying to do, whether that we're in a physical store, whether we're a digital experience, or whether we're talking to you in the morning on your mobile device.
Can we talk about people are going to get the opportunity to have a physical experience?
Yes. You know, I think that I get so emotionally disturbed when people go, oh, stores are going to go away. That is nonsense. They're not going to go away. But the role of physical environments are going to change, whether you're a one-store operation or whether you're a large, you know, multi-store behemoth, right? People still want community. People still want to engage, and people still want to have a touch and feel experience. But they're going to want it to service them in different ways depending on what it is. They're going to want ease. You know, I just happened to be out in Seattle, and they have the test of the new Amazon Go store, which right now only employees can use, where you literally walk in, you put stuff in your bag, and you walk out. And it's facial recognition and wallet recognition. And, you know, what's interesting is a couple of people who did it said, oh, my God, I felt like I was shoplifting when I walked out. Okay? But what's that about? That's about ease of experience, right?
Yeah.
Or, you know, I'm telling you, the future, you're going to be in your car, and you're going to be able to fill up, you know, you're going to fill up your gas tank, you're going to go through the toll, you're going to park in the parking meter, and you're going to go through Starbucks, and you're never going to have to do anything because your payment's going to be in your car. Now, all of that, you can say it's shocking, but at the end of the day, it's ease of use for the consumer. But going back to physical, so we have an incredible portfolio of catalog businesses, Frontgate, Ballard Design, Grandin Road, Garnet Hill, and Improvements. And what we said was, we have an incredible ability to communicate with those customers through our digital and catalog, but so many of them want to see that product come to life. So we're actually going into the physical experiences. We now have 3 Ballard Design Studio stores. One's right here in Tyson Corner. It's fabulous. King of Prussia, Natick, we're opening more. The center of the entire store is a design studio where there's 1,000 ways to customize a chair. You can meet with a design professional. We're empowering you to be your own designer. There's on-demand, right in the middle of the store, monogramming for anything you would have. So that idea of customization and personalization brought to life. And then we open our first Frontgate flagship store outside of Dallas at the end of May. It's a big investment for us, a 25,000 square foot store, indoor space, outdoor space, atrium, wine bar, cafe, events, really trying to create a destination within the community. Now, because we've been a direct-to-consumer business, we know who our customers are in an area. But our reason for doing this is not just, certainly we want to make money on a four-wall basis, but it's also to lift to the direct business and create more of a destination and experience on a basis, and we'll be rolling those out. So, you know, I do think those physical experiences are very important, but they have to be married. They have to be married to innovation and technology, and they have to be part of a 360-degree experience, because as far as I'm concerned, where the customer wants to check out, I don't care.
Yeah. I have to tell you that my brother-in-law is probably now a very nervous man to know that my sister has access to a physical front gate store, not all that far away from where they live. So I will chat with him later today to let him know. Get ready, Dr. Jeff. Let's go. You in January became the chair of the National Retail Federation. Prior to that, you had worked with the foundation. Tell us a little bit about, because some people may not be that familiar as we enter into this partnership, with what the Retail Federation does, and then a little bit about the foundation.
Sure. Well, it's an incredible honor to be chairman of the NRF and work with Matt Shea, Ellen, and everyone else on that team who've done incredible things over the last number of years. So we are the largest trade organization for the retail industry in the world, certainly in the U.S. As we mentioned, it's one in four jobs, but it's also a very powerful industry. And so what the NRF does is certainly advocates on behalf of what is, an incredible retail community and what the needs are, what the issues are, and how can we support the constituency. And what I love about the NRF is we represent that single store operator in a small community all the way up to retailers like Target who have thousands of stores. So we understand consumers and retailers, because our retailers are also the consumers, I think more than anyone can possibly do. So very powerful. We also serve as a tremendous support and research arm, as well as a key element of ensuring that we're bringing the right talent into the retail industry for us to be competitive. So I did serve as chairman of the NRF Foundation for 4 years, working with Ellen as we transformed it, and she mentioned many of the accomplishments. But the idea of having the ability to both educate through research, to be able to support our constituencies, to be able to provide scholarships and educate the educators, and now to be able to have this incredible credentialing program to bring individuals into the retail workforce. I think that's a very powerful platform to be able to do. And the other thing that's certainly, important, if you look at the retail industry, it supports not just diversity of jobs, but diversity of people and opportunity in careers, and that's gender diversity, multi-ethnic diversity. It's a wide open forum for people, whether they're coming in as an entry level or they're working up. And my first job, I was the assistant to the president at a menswear company 40 years ago. I was young. I'm so old. One of my first jobs, I was talking last night, that one of my jobs was to send the telexes out at night. Can you imagine? I think of what this industry has afforded me. In a million years, I didn't start out thinking I'd be sitting in this seat, but I was curious, and I took textile technology courses at night, and, I learned, and, I embraced every opportunity throughout my career to do and learn different things. And there's very few industries that would have allowed me, especially then as a woman, to have had these opportunities. So it's an incredible, industry and incredible career.
I think that's a great lead in. We are getting questions. Thank you very much. Hashtag ask industry. And that does lead into a question. Someone's asking, what advice do you give women leaders and managers seeking to advance in not only your industry, in any industry? I mean, obviously you are a very accomplished person, but also a woman, yeah, in a very...
I do spend a lot of time thinking of that, because diversity and inclusion is a very important element and certainly platform for me. And I think as a a woman leader who've had the privilege and the honor to have a platform, not to be able to communicate that would be a missed opportunity. The first thing that I would say, the most powerful thing you can own, the most powerful thing you can own is belief in yourself. Because if you don't believe in yourself, why is someone else? And, you know, I think as women, we have a tendency to want to be perfect. You know, we want to tie the bow before we're willing to put ourselves out there. But if you believe in yourself, that goes a long way. I think the second thing is focus on making other people successful. Now, that may sound like an oxymoron if you want to be successful. But if you read Adam Grant's book, Give and Take, it's really about like the power of empowering others. And my feeling is if I work to make others successful, they will be successful, which means my business will be successful, which ultimately will make me successful. Now, that doesn't mean you shouldn't speak out for yourself. But I think that's a second. The third is put yourself out there and raise your hand. So anytime I was in a company and I had an opportunity to be on a task force or to get out of, let's call it my rung of business and get an experience somewhere else, I took it. Especially when I was younger, because it allowed me to not only be looked at as a person in a vertical channel, right? So I've had roles in sales, marketing, merchandising, production. You know, I wanted to learn everything because it gave me a holistic view of the business. And then, you know, lastly, support one another and understand the power of diversity. And I like to say diversity is not just about gender. I'm not going to be the smartest person in the room, but I'm going to surround myself with a lot of people who have a diversity of experience that are going to challenge me in positive ways, that are going to teach me. And I always say I want to surround myself with people who are cool, curious, and connected. And cool doesn't mean how you dress, right? It means that you're curious. It means that you're interesting. It means that I want to be with you, right? Because you're cool, which means that you're probably curious. And it means you surround yourself with people like you. Because the way you have to think of it, for every one person you hire, think of their network.
Oh, yeah.
Because that is going to help you find the other people.
It does raise another question came from the audience about the talent that you hire. Obviously, the folks out here connected with the American Job Centers, the board itself. What kind of suggestions do you have for them about how to connect to the retail sector in their community? And a little bit then about the talent that you all look for.
So, you know, I'm a very big believer that you hire for two things. You don't just hire a resume. You hire for skills and you hire for culture. And the most important thing is understanding that culture ultimately is what is going to help drive long-term business success. And, you know, I've been very fortunate in my career to have some incredible mentors like Phil Knight, to work for some very embedded cultures like a Nike or like a Ralph Lauren. And when I joined HSN, one of the first things was to reignite the culture. I was the eighth CEO in 10 years. So you had to reignite the passion and what people believed in and what the future of the company was. So, you know, today we understand, we run a business, let's call it HSN, it runs 24 hours a day, it's live. We plan our business by minute. Think about that. Average weighted dollars per minute, margin per minute, and customers per minute. So you gotta be moving, right? So we know that we have to hire people who are curious, who are agile, and who are collaborative. You know, we're in such a fast-moving environment that you have to support each other. You have to be very consumer-centric. You have to have qualitative and quantitative skills. So we look at all of that and we put that through a lens. So, you know, when I look at the, young people or people re-entering the workforce, maybe after having come out of the workforce, I would say that we need to empower people with both things, quantitative and qualitative skills, and certainly in developing Rise Up, that was a very big part of the equation. If you look at training programs, are you hiring people to be able to connect with human beings? We forget how important that is and how that creates loyalty. And it's very important.
And so it's that first step is meeting with that business to understand what their culture is, what their attitude is, what they're
looking for,
what experience they want the consumer to have, because that gives us clues as to the kind of people.
It's really about serving needs and wants and creating the ability to bring people in. Especially if you think about it, small businesses, if you only have the opportunity to be able to have a small number of employees that are going to help you grow, every one of those employees is critical to the success of the business, and they themselves have to feel invested. And it's no different when you get to kind of a bigger business. And the way I think of, every employee is, how am I using that employee to have not just a financial return on capital, but an emotional return on capital? And how am I building that employee's career? Because we all know turnover is an anathema, right, to our ability to do business. And if we're developing talent, we want to keep that talent. Right. And in order to do that, we have to motivate them. We have to create a connection. They have to want to be in the culture. And so that's very important today as well. And we think that, particularly with Rise Up, if we know that we're hiring someone that has those capabilities and they've been through this program, and more important, they've stuck through it and they've graduated, right? That to me is kind of almost like a good housekeeping seal of approval, right? We have someone coming in, and if we can ultimately reduce turnover by X percent within any retailer, that's worth huge amounts of equity in a business. And then if those people graduate and continue to evolve into careers, that is return on equity that you can't pay for.
And that's kind of fun to watch, isn't it?
Of course it is.
To watch somebody grow. I mean, look at JD. Do we have time for one more question? We got one, maybe two questions? Okay. All right. Been in several questions from people in the audience about different, what we would call in our industry, target groups. So veterans, persons with disabilities, young people who have had some, let's say, challenges with the, or connection with the, with the juvenile justice system. Is retail an industry they can think about, should think about?
Absolutely, they should think about.
An industry ready to accept them?
We are an industry ready to accept that. And that's a lot of what Rise Up is going to serve, are some of these underserved populations where, through whatever reasons, didn't have the best start, whether that's educational, whether those issues, veterans, et cetera. We can provide the skills and training. We all need entry-level jobs. And you heard the statistics. There are 600,000 unfilled jobs that we need. And that ladders up to many different levels. And as Ellen mentioned, Rise Up is the base platform, but ultimately we want to be able to serve the needs at every level. So whether they're the scholarship programs going into different careers, but we can't exist as an industry if we're not bringing in qualified individuals for these entry-level jobs that are going to turn into careers. And we certainly want to support and address those populations.
There's a question about the impact of like Netflix and Hulu, but earlier you and I were talking about the platform that you guys are developing, and I thought it was fascinating. Can you talk a little bit about how you all are looking at the platform and the gaming, the conversations you've had with the gaming industry?
Well, it goes back to what technology is enabling us to do today that we never thought possible. So content used to be linear, live, and once it was gone, it was gone. Well, today, content can live. Content can live off platform. So in our HSM business, we're in all the OTT platforms with shoppable video content. So that could be Roku, Apple TV, all the live streaming, shopping, Samsung, LG, all those devices today. And if you look at it on some of these platforms, we have three channels. So you can go into an electronic channel and learn about technology, a beauty channel, because the world today, certainly you can have a live experience, but we all want an on-demand experience. The second thing that technology is enabling us to do is not just focus on the demographics of customers, but the psychographics of customers and what they want. So if we know our HSN customer's psychographic is she loves to shop, as I said to you before, that's why I understand her, because shopping is discovery and entertainment. She loves to share. This is a very social woman, mostly women. So 70% of our customers, over 70%, are on Facebook, and they check it at least three times a day. So you can imagine the power of that marketing vehicle. Wow. But why does she love the storytelling platform that we have at HSN? Because when someone says to her, I like something in your home or I like something you're wearing, she then can tell them the story behind it, and that's empowering to her. But then I will get the social amplification of that. And then the third thing is we know that she also likes casual games. Women to 35 to 60 make up 65% of casual gameplay. That could be Words with Friends, it could be Candy Crush, whatever. So we said, well, if we know she loves these three things, why can't she do it all with us? So I actually, out of curiosity, I spent a week in Seattle, a week in San Francisco, meeting with every casual and social gaming company, and we launched HSN Arcade, which is the first retail gaming portal. So she can come, she can play games, she can watch the live stream, she can win points, she can redeem those points. And we now have 1.2 million registered game players who are some of our most loyal customers. But it goes back to use insights and data to understand and personalize the experience in ways you never thought possible.
I'll be curious to see how many hits you guys get at this hour of the morning from
Washington, D.C. Well, actually, just to let you know, every night at midnight, we launch something called the Day's Special. Today's Special. It's the item of the day. I think today is tan towels. Yesterday was an LG television. So we release a jigsaw puzzle of whatever the item is. And the person within a certain amount of time during the day who puts the jigsaw puzzle together the fastest wins whatever the item is. And they play as much if it's a $19.99 item as if it's a $1,499 item. Because you know why? People have fun, they're engaged. And you know what? We all want to win. It's gamification, it's fun.
So tonight when they're all sitting in McClellan's, you guys can, because I know you'll be there at midnight, you can all work to put together the pieces of the puzzle and win.
And then somebody said it wasn't fair because we're live, so when it's midnight on the East Coast, it's 9 o'clock in LA, so they get first dibs or something. But people wait up.
I want to give you, Mindy, I want to give you some opportunity for closing thoughts. For an industry that's moving, I mean, as we talked before, it's starting to recognize the consumer. It's starting to recognize that we've got to change how we do business. In your experience in moving companies, and you've moved several of them into today, what would be the lessons that you would want to say, here are the things that stuck with me, struck me in that experience of moving these companies, these organizations to still be viable, to still be relevant? What are those lessons?
Yeah, so there definitely have been lessons. You know, I'm known as a transformer of businesses, which to me is very exciting. It can be scary at times. Look, for most people, change and transformation can seem scary. So the number one thing is incredible, constant communication and articulation of the vision of why. Make people understand that change is ongoing and is not going to go away. We're living in an environment that transformation is empowering, and it can enable people to do things they never thought possible. That technology is actually our friend, not our foe, because it's going to enable things, and it's going to enable people to do things they never thought was possible. So you need to embed within your culture this desire to understand, to create change, and to have understanding. But you also need to have realistic goals, check-in, and accountability. Because if you're transforming, you're not going to do everything overnight. So you have to have steps along the way. You have to check in. You've got to be able to course correct, right? And it's okay to make a mistake. It's okay to course correct when you're going through transformation. But you need to learn from it. And that everybody in your organization has to understand their role in that. So as leaders, that ability to constantly communicate in every way. And we have so many capabilities to communicate because of digital technology today. You can stay in touch with every one of your constituencies constantly, and you can reward them for transformational behavior in different ways. But I would say that's the most important thing.
It's been my pleasure to spend time with you this morning, and I hope that I know that I have learned a lot. I am sure that folks out there have learned a lot. Mindy Grossman, CEO for HSNI,
thank you
very much.